Better Yoshi! Pro Gamer!
Hey everyone, Better Yoshi Pro Gamer here, and this is the 23rd episode of my Let's Play of Mario Golf Advance Tour. We were taken to that menu because we had just finished the Lynx tournament, the singles mode. You know, we had done doubles before, but now there's a new cutscene. You were getting mobbed, huh? I wanted to congratulate you, but it was too nuts. How awesome are you? You beat Kid, won the Lynx title, and now you're the ultimate singles golfer. There's the championship trophy. A turning that difficult is out of my league, right? Well, no. I mean, you know, we conquered it together before I did it myself, so... No somber words here. But L is cool. L is cool. We're partners, and that's what matters. I think I'll head to my room and come if you need me. Which, of course, is inevitable because her room is in between my room and the exit. So all that's left to do before heading to the mushroom course is to take down Kid. You know, student versus teacher. But otherwise, we have done every other side game. And we have done every other match and tournament otherwise. Yep. Even Elf Short Course. As you've seen previously, that took under 10 minutes. Because I was able to learn from my mistakes and capitalize on, anytime that the wind was low and play good punches. So now back to the Lynx course. And we shall... I don't know what I was doing there, but... time to challenge Kid. I thought I'd be seeing you sooner or later. Fast Texas fast. Since you've taken the Lynx championship, a singles match... Don't think I'll go easy on you because you're my student. Give me everything you got. So, unfortunately, this means no amazingly awesome genius music, but we do get slightly less epic final boss-ish sort of music that I had previewed. I had teased through the ending of the previous video and. Released the full length of the music as its own intermission upload. It's quite lively and it does its job pretty well. But yeah, you know, Kid is strong, but I find that he can get himself into trouble, and sometimes he's unable to get himself out and then get green in regulation. So right now he's struggling a little bit. So. I will have to capitalize on that, especially since with the Super POWs and the distance investment that I've put in over the course of this Let's Play, you know, I have a massive Happy Gilmore-like advantage off the tee. Whereas, you know, right now it's kind of like, you know, Happy versus Shooter McGavin, except, well... Kid is considerably less of a douchebag than Shooter McGavin was. Whereas me, you know, I resemble Mowgli far more than an aspiring hockey player. Yeah, I still think Happy Gilmore is probably Adam Sandler's best. I'm not sure, but I mean. If you have a severely different opinion, or if you think I'm terribly wrong, then please say so in the comments. Ooh, Kid's getting aggressive again. Pulling out the big dog, and he's doing... trying to catch as much of the wind as possible, and topspin. And I'm not even sure if he caught any fast fairway, but that's a damn good drive. However, he does not have all that great of a lie, kind of a... crisp, bare grass there, but he nails it, so I'll have to be prepared to try to nab an eagle here. All right. It's on, kid. It is on. You're not kidding around, you know? Though, I'll get your goat, though. Lol. How many jokes and puns can I put in one episode? Oh, speaking of jokes and puns, I've been trying to incorporate puns into my titles of my episodes. Ooh, kid. You sallied it. Which one has been your favorite? Were you fond of any of the Sherry-related ones? Or, you know, any of the, like, other golf-related ones, you know, that I could think of off the top of my head? Or, floons and dooms and dooms and tongue twisters like that. And I like alliteration as well, and things that kind of sound good together. Let me know what you think. I mean, you know, we're getting to the point where it's like, you know, things are wrapping up, and you know, we're able to reminisce and reflect on the good times. And kid, you know, you're lucky you landed on that stuff. Otherwise, you could have gone far, far further. Other than butchering that putt on the last hole, he's been playing decently. But I'd expect him to try stepping up his game. I think part of why I'm having a fairly easy time here alongside the super POW and distance investment is that the matches are played from the front tees as opposed to the back, and so some of these holes are not don't play as treacherously long as they could be. Kid unfortunately has to lag back over here. You have to hit a very hard ball to go where I've gone, and even then. Yep, Pepsi Max break. Forget Mountain Dew. Pepsi Max is the drink of gamers. And I say that because, I mean, you know, who needs all those calories, you know, and just, like, crap that goes in your body? Like, well, there's still a lot of crap that goes in your body with, like, you know, Pepsi Max or whatever, but, I mean, I'm sure you and I can all agree that, you know, Gatorade and Powerade are shipping. They're all just pretty much like, I guess what I would call athletic placebo drinks. Like, you know, they target wannabe athletes, and that, you know, they're so popular because athletes endorse them. You know, that sort of thing. And, you know, water's just like, water really, you know, but I mean, in all honesty, water's pretty awesome. But it's like, other than whatever minerals are in it, water just is. It's like the most neutral thing possible. Unless, say, for instance, it acts as an acid or a base in an acid-based reaction, which, you know, its role could be that it would take or lend hydrogen ions in a reaction respectively. Man, kid's playing decently all of a sudden here. I gotta keep my game up. But yeah, now to actually explain why Pepsi Max should be a drink of gamers is that it is a glorious blend of Pepsi upon which it is double the caffeine but none of the calories of regular Pepsi. And it's a diet sort of product. Actually tastes pretty decent for a diet soda product. Ah, this hole again, you know, this longish par 3 with the fast fairway guarding it, and there's a big, big crosswind. But hey, I'd rather have a headwind than a tailwind, so it accentuates the backspin. See, it was a 5-iron with backspin, and you could tell from watching, 10 hours of, you know, Let's Play here, that ball stopped substantially quicker than it would normally. Yeah, the artificial intelligence that is Robot Kid kind of had a hard time figuring out what to do there. But hey, most opponents would. But really, with this green, it's like, if you could get yourself into any of those flat areas, then there's really not much slope, and you just sink your putt. Like, sometimes the objective to play well in Mario Golf games, and golf games in general, is not really so much get super close as much as leave yourself the easiest putt. And then it's just a matter of getting the distance right. I always end up going way, way farther than the mark indicates it should. I don't know what Kid is doing. He's kind of being aggressive. He's getting aggressive again. But he does have the strength to back himself up. Yeah, he's getting unlucky right now, and some of that unluckiness is stemming from the fact that he had to play from heather grass that pretty much almost maximizes his margin for error. That's the problem with being in bad lies, is that I shouldn't say so much margin for error as much as distance variation. You see, you probably figured out those numbers in the lower right corner, plus minus 5%. Right now I'm in bunker. But yeah, that can depend on the length of the club you use and the lie it is, but that means that your shot could go substantially harder or softer than you would like it to in bad situations. But, you know, I make better use of that than Kid does, and thus I win hole number 7. I am almost playing a speed golf-like game as long as the wind is low because, you know, I have the strength to be able to generally get myself green in regulation on just about any given hole. I almost feel bad. It's like, maybe I should, you know, do something sort of like, you know, post-LP or addendum episodes where I do certain things in the game using without using custom clubs. Oh man, Kid, you're choking again, man. Damn, you're really choking, man. It's really choking. Like, I mean, yeah, you get yourself behind a hazard, but at least try not to land in another hazard in the process. Oh man. You know, at this stage of the game, if you're still parring par fives, then like that one ski instructor dude in South Park that I always see those image macros of, but I never exactly remember who he is, you're gonna have a bad time. That's the problem with memes. It's like, you know, it's like their origins get clouded by the passage of time. Unless they're well documented by conglomerates and, you know, things like Know Your Meme, for instance. But yeah, Eagle Putt. Sorry that I have to, you know, thrash my teacher so badly, but it's like, no way. You know, that's what happens when among your four students you happen to have a latent prodigy that, you know, we don't know what turns of events have happened before the game started. You know, it's like all we know is that Kid is the instructor that had basically just, as according to the first episode, like the intro text, taught them the fundamentals. And then, you know, gives everyone the shocker, and it's almost like a figurative middle finger that's like, I'm thinking of, you know, that I'm trying to relearn everything all over myself. So it's almost like, can we really trust what knowledge you've imparted upon us? Okay, so it seems as though I've gotten myself in a pickle now. Oh wait, I'm going under. I'm playing a punch. Well, I suppose I can if I'm playing almost a mid iron, you know, from some of the thickest grass in the game. Seems fair. Yeah, Although I gotta give Kid credit though. I mean, it's like, no. Like, unless you have a fundamental technique and you just know what you're doing, it is just the most unintuitive thing to hit bunker shots. Like, in real life, I just can't do it. I mean, I know I'm supposed to, like, tilt the club so it's more or less, it's like flatter, and then, you know, kind of like have a quote open stance to where it's like, you know, like the relation of my feet and the club sort of have a wider angle, but, and that creates more loft, but, and I'm supposed to like shoot into the sand and come out, but execution, it's like, that's a whole nother thing. Yeah, so, I don't know, I just got a brain fart. I kind of lost track of, what I was, talking about before. I don't know, I heard a weird noise or something else like that, but holy crap, Dormy already? Man, this could be a shorter episode than I expected. But yeah, it's like, all I have to do is at least tie, which, you know, on a par four is... Wow. That fast fairway. Like, okay, you know, here's another thing that I, you know, may suggest for comments, you know, like commentary is, how do you think fast fairway works? And, like, is there anything analogous to it in real life? Because, you know, the way that fast fairway works in this game is that when you land on it or you roll on it, then it greatly increases the bounce or the roll that the ball takes when it's exposed to it. So, like, is it just, like, you know, incredibly thin grass, like, to the point where, like, the ground is hard? Or, like, is there some kind of, like, you know, crazy Mario logic going on with it? Or, like, I still do not have a good theory as to how fast fairway works. Alright, well, Kid got birdie, but it's a sink and win situation. Medal's taken away, as it is the case with every odd tie. Wow, 751 experience. That is a lot. I think probably, though, by the margin in which you defeat somebody is very, can highly determine how much experience you get. And I think I've obtained a little bit more experience than might be typical in a playthrough. Perhaps because of the performances in side games and tournaments and other things like that. So I've defeated Kid, I'm the ultimate golfer, and now he's chasing me and will have his revenge. Okay. The reason I wanted to talk to him again is because I was trying to remember how to get the custom ticket D. Okay, so I'm refreshing that, boy your rivals, whatever, and yeah, I'm mashing buttons too quickly. Oh, that's right, yes. I looked at the big tree and there's a one up there that I forgot to get, but actually now is about as good of a time as ever to get it because, no, I'm leveled up to the point where regardless it takes 350 experience to get it, and so essentially what it does is it saves me at most 350 experience, but pretty much the best way to get tons of experience is to play the most difficult tournaments and do well at them, and then you could probably get an excess of 1500 experience each time, so that's good for four levels. I bring a message from Princess Peach. This is the light at the stained glass of Mario. Wouldn't you say competing against the likes of Mario and Luigi would be the dream? Some dreams come true. So here we go, we are going to go to Peach's castle. That's a pretty awesome way of getting there, you know? It's it's a lot more mystical and it's a lot cooler than say in Mario Tennis Power Tour, whichever the one the Game Boy Advance one was, where you fly a plane into the clouds where Princess's Castle is, and it's like, okay. But yeah, like, you know, being absorbed into an orb that comes out of a stained glass window, that's pretty awesome, you know? I came to just turn to crush Mario, Mamma Mia! And it's like, you know, for whatever reason, everyone's bickering with each other, and Princess is like, cool, you two, then we have a guest! It's like, okay, yeah, I can't do women, I can't do it fast, and you were quite lucky, David, we're about to compete on the newly built course. And you will see that the course is kind of a hybrid between the elements of Peach's course and Bowser Badlands in Toadstool Tour. Although, not quite so many warp pipes, unfortunately, probably just because it would be difficult to do that sort of fully three-dimensional aiming and all that other stuff. The same reason that you don't play shoot through rings in this and instead you shoot through gates. But anyways, I denied going to the tournament right away because, if I recall correctly, I'm trying to trigger something that is in the barrel. I thought there was something in that barrel, but otherwise, you know, exploring here, you know, there's just lovely flowers and pools and toads. I've been practicing nothing but tennis, so my golf skills are rusty. Is tennis cool again? Yeah, a neat little cross-reference, I guess. And there's a little table, you know, for no reason. Okay, so yeah, I guess the reason I have to get that barrel from the back of the castle, so I have to maybe just fidget around the right way. Hopefully maybe I can get it this time. Come on. Barrel, please. Barrel? What are you doing? Oh, look in the barrel. Okay. It's another one-up. Kick ass. Now, I'm feeding myself pretty much because I only need Ella one more time, but that'll be for later. So, you know, we're at about 22 and a half minutes here, and so this is a pretty good time here to wrap things up. And, yeah, we'll cover the Mushroom Tournament singles next time. And then that'll be the penultimate episode. So we will do that singles tournament. And then, but I'll have a big surprise for the final episode when I bring Ella. So thank you for watching. See you next time.